Imagine you've got this resource. It holds 3 times more carbon than the atmosphere. It prevents flooding and makes everything grow. It produces the majority of our food and sustains all the organisms we need to survive.
Now imagine that this resource is being destroyed, taking away all these benefits. Stop imagining. This is real. This is the story of our soil. How on earth did we get here? To understand, we need to trace our steps back to the 1950s. The UK was in the aftermath of World War II. After a decade of severe food shortage and rationing, the nation needed to produce more food. New farming techniques were rapidly developed in a time of agricultural intensification.
Across the country, farmers were incentivized to clear trees, hedges, and margins to create farmland.
Crops were sprayed with chemical fertilizers and pesticides to increase yields.
Livestock were moved into barns and given highly processed rapid growth feed.
While driven by noble intentions, these new methods were causing immense damage to our soil.
Today, most of the UK's land is used by farmers, so the health of our soil and the benefits it provides us rest in the hands of our farmers.
But a revolution to repair the damage is underway. Many farmers are turning away from intensive practice and are farming in a way that regenerates our soil and farms for our future.
My name's David Oates. I am an organic farmer down on the Lizard Peninsula in Cornwall. Our whole farm ethos is around farming to help the environment as well as producing food. It's easy to showcase stuff in the summer, isn't it? But I always think if a farmer isn't willing to show you around in the middle of winter, they're not really proud of what they're doing. We're planting a lot of agroforestry at the moment. In the last month, we've planted over 6,000 trees. This is a typical planting setup as we're doing it. Good old bit of Cornish weather today. We've drilled the hole using a hydraulic auger on the digger. We put a shovel full of homemade organic compost in the bottom of every hole, a wooden stake to hold it, a guard. Quite satisfying. That's it, that's 26. This field is going to be a traditional orchard. Native breed apples, lots of heritage varieties. We're trying to make this one look a bit natural, whereas the one at the top of the field is more of a modern variety in straight alleys, so that we can work machinery around them and graze into paddocks. We've got blueberries, raspberries and blackcurrants planted in between every row. So hopefully it will give us an extra diversity of income. The use of electric fencing is really important. We can move the fence in and out so that cows can graze right to the base of a tree without affecting it, without being able to rub on it and damage it. This is one of our rubbing stones. Every field traditionally would have had a stone in the middle of it. Cows would choose to rub these stones instead of rubbing on the trees and damaging them. Planting any tree is a good thing. We definitely need more trees to look after our soil, to build our soil, help the biodiversity and the nutrients inside that soil. The crops we grow around them, they should all benefit. The more trees, the more nesting sites, the more habitat. If I didn't move forward with planting these trees and moving our whole farm to regenerative practices, our costs of keeping animals and producing meat would spiral up. These are long-term plans and I probably won't really see the benefits for 5, 10, 20 years, but this will reduce costs and produce a higher quality food product for the consumer as well as looking after the environment.
Hi, I'm Chris Jones. I'm the owner of Woodland Valley Farm and lead partner in the Cornwall Beaver Project. We are a regenerative farm, which means we produce food in a way that improves our soil and biodiversity. We really, really want to look after our soil as much as we can. It's absolutely our life support system. But we haven't always farmed this way. Back in the 90s, we had 270 cattle here. That was very, very, very intensive. To farm in an intensive way requires the use of all sorts of chemistry, which has the capacity to wipe out lots of food web. We cannot go on growing food in such a way that we poison our water and we destroy all the other biodiversity. In our own little way, we're trying to turn the corner on that. We currently have 30, 40 cattle here. There are 15 fields. We move the cattle across all those fields. We're having short, intensive grazing periods with very long recovery periods. We actually need the effect on the landscape of big animals walking across it, squashing grass into the ground, putting dung all over the place. Without that, it becomes very, very sterile very, very quickly. We're going over now to move the cows, which we do daily. But it's a lovely morning. Feel that sunshine. If the animals are here for a long, long time, covering the whole field, there is scope for the soil being squashed down, and air excluded. For soil to really work well, it needs to have a lot of air in it. Okay, so the first bit is really easy, and that is just to switch the fence off. Hey, Freckles. Apart from the fact that I'm restricting where they go every day, these cattle are living life almost like a wild mammal would. But they don't have big predators, that's all. I'm the big predator. Right, move the cows, electric fencer. Come on. Good girl. Straight through, heads down, and eating. So that's really good. I'm now going to pick the fence up behind them. What we can see here now, actually, is a little bit of biodiversity creeping in. This little gorse bush has come here. It's a great plant for pollinators and so on, mainly because it's in flower nearly all the year round. And this kind of tufty grass here is providing the absolute number one habitat for rodents, which are being hunted by short-eared owls, which I didn't even know we could get in Cornwall. And it's because we're, through the cattle management, growing a much more natural grass and habitat. It's like, if you build it, they will come. Yeah. That's nice. Okay. It's coming close to lunchtime. I'm almost at the point of needing to have a little sit down. Lunch. Beavers used to live all across the country, but were hunted to extinction by the 16th century. Today, beavers are being reintroduced across Britain, and this is having a staggering impact on the environment.
I was very interested in the rewilding debate from a long time ago.
and that beavers were already being brought back into the country. I knew we had a good site here. We thought, let's get them back down to Cornwall. What we've done here is build an enclosure which holds a beaver family, mum and dad, and a kit that's 2 years old. We want to show it's easy to have livestock living with or near to beavers. There's no downside to that. Right, let's head down to the water where we can see the stream as it was before the beavers arrived. And although it looks like we kind of expect a lovely stream to be like, it's utterly unnatural because we don't have our beavers present. If we look just a little bit upstream here, we can see how utterly the beavers alter everything. Beavers need water for protection from predators. If they don't have enough water, they create it by building dams. They have immensely strong teeth for cutting down trees, for building those dams. It's a bit like a water battery. Before the beavers came, if there's a rainstorm, the battery would charge up, but discharge just as quickly. And today what's happening is the discharge is really, really, really slowly. If it's helping to prevent flooding somewhere really matters, that's a good thing. As beavers cut down trees, it allows more light to reach the ground, which lets more vegetation grow, all helping to cycle nutrients into the bankside soil. It's as if the beavers are actually farming the riverbanks. To where my finger is mud or silt from the bottom of this pond that's behind us. Before the beavers came, this mud was not here. It couldn't be here because there's nothing to hold it here. This soil eroded from nearby farmland. It's being held in the landscape in this beaver dam. If we have a lot of beavers out there, it will help farmers keep the nutrients and the soil on the farm at a very low cost. The main issue against the widespread reintroduction of beavers is to do with farming. I don't see the agricultural capacity of this farm reduced one iota by having these beavers here. Two droughts we've had since the beavers came here, 2018 and 2022, and both those years we had spare water we could actually take out of here. And it actually helps keep our cattle through drought as well. This is costing very little to actually produce this extraordinary little piece of landscape. You know, we can't plough our rivers, we can't plant potatoes in rivers. Wouldn't it be good if they were handed back to nature for the sake of the rivers themselves and get them cleaned up, for the sake of our fellow citizens, so we reduce the amount of flood and the amount of water pollution? We're a terribly, terribly nature-depleted country, and having these animals back would be really good for nature, and it would be good for us too. And when I say we, or us, I mean farmers, let alone everyone else. I do think farmers as being now the critical audience, because anything that happens in the environment basically happens on someone's farm.
There is a lot of terrible farming practices that goes on around the world. But farming is a complex thing and every farm is different and every approach is different. You can produce food and you can look after the environment all at the same time.
People's livelihoods depend on farming. Regenerative farming is cheaper, less susceptible to diesel, electric, and feed prices.
To farmers, I would say this is by far the cheapest way to produce meat or milk that there is going. There is no cheaper way than feeding your cattle on grass. To consumers, I would say the produce you get from a system like this is by far the most healthy you can get. If you want to look after yourself, this is the stuff to look out for.